is your position on a statewide or nationally mandated healthcare system? What actions would you take regarding what is often referred to as Obamacare? Starting with Kevin Chisholm.
You know, healthcare is really complicated, and there's a tendency to oversimplify it. I'm going to try not to do it. Even doctors have widely varied opinions about it. I'd like to see more effort and cost put in treating patients and less in administrating things, fighting whether that person should be given that care or not. It's a tragic thing. I'd like to study and see what happens in Vermont and Massachusetts. A couple of these states have got great ideas going forward. We should try to mimic those, revise whatever we might do nationally to meet the sensible and smart things that come out of those efforts.
Tim Dunn.
Well, I think most of us here would agree that Obamacare is a disaster and needs to be repealed, defunded, or hopefully found to be unconstitutional by the Supreme Court. But let's not confuse the fact that Obamacare is the wrong prescription for our healthcare problems with the fact that we don't have any problems in our healthcare system. We do. The system was broken before Obamacare. And what we need is free market reforms in healthcare. And that includes bringing down the senseless barriers between states that prohibit people from being able to buy insurance across state lines. We need a dramatic expansion of health savings accounts that allow people to take greater control of their own health care. And we need businesses, small businesses, to be able to pool their resources. And we also need tort reform and hopefully a loser pays policy that will reduce all the costs involved that get passed on to you and me, the consumer.
E.W. Jackson.
I wouldn't call our healthcare system broken. We have two problems. We got a cost problem and we got a distribution problem. The cost problem is that the costs keep going up because of government involvement and regulation and attempts to control healthcare. And of course, the distribution problem is the issue of people who need healthcare who can't afford it and what we do about that. And so I think probably most of us on this panel would agree that market forces are the way. But the first thing we've got to do in order to approach it is to get rid of Obamacare and then rethink the healthcare system by biting off the pieces that are bad. Look, you can't call it simply broken when everybody in the world wants to come to the United States of America to get healthcare because we offer the finest healthcare in the world.
David McCormick.
Well, first of all, we do have the best healthcare system in the world, but when I heard about the Obama healthcare plan, I said, are you kidding me? Are you stepping in between a doctor and their patient? Are you going to have a death panel decide who gets Medicare, Medicaid, or the proper hospitalization? And number three, are you really going to microchip bodies that take the health option, which is described on page 1000? But I tell you, this Obama health care plan is a socialist plan that will bring in socialism in the highest degree that you would never imagine in our nation. It needs to be repealed. I differ from Mr. Jackson because I believe I'm such a constitutionalist that our government has no business on a federal level to be in the healthcare business. Now, I do agree with Mr. Donner that free enterprise and free business and free market solutions are the answer. And I have some good common sense tips for my state delegates and state senators on what they could do on reform at a state level. But it is a state local level if they want to put something in place, but not the federal government. Stay out of here.
And let's be clear that I didn't say the federal government, I said market forces, but since Tim Donner already gave a good summary, I saw no need to repeat it.
You're going to applaud, aren't you? In what cases do you believe government has the right to seize private property under eminent domain? And what is your position on the U.S. Supreme Court's decision in the Kelo case? Starting with E.W. Jackson, please.
Well, first of all, I don't believe that the federal government has any right to seize property for eminent domain short of some sort of emergency national security issue. What has happened recently with the federal government using, and of course in the Kelo case, or for that matter, state or local governments using economic development as an excuse for seizing people's property and kicking them out is completely unconstitutional in my view, which is another reason why we've got to get rid of President Obama. We've got to have a president who will appoint Supreme Court justices who actually believe that the Constitution says what it means and respect the property rights of American citizens. So, no, I think it's a very, very, very narrow ability to do that, and I think it's being completely abused right now.
David McCormick.
Well, eminent domain, it is wrong to take property from an American. It's their property, they have earned it. And this test should be so stringent before you would ever take real estate from anyone, even one square inch. And it should never be used for commercial purposes to develop that country land. There should be such a narrow exception, like when you need to have a transportation highway or you need a rail yard. But in that case, it absolutely has to be strictly proven with the right cause, the best interest, and the property owner should have every right of remedy in a court hearing at the highest court level before they would to turn over any property whatsoever. But we got to aggressively fight against what's happening with Kalo's decision. It's wrong for America, and we need to straighten that out immediately.
Kevin Chisholm.
I agree a lot with what Mr. McCormick just said. And there are cases for eminent domain, and fair compensation is critical to that. But the case where, I think this is the case you're referring to, where private property was taken to develop a shopping area or something to that effect, I just made me want to pull my hair out. I couldn't believe it. I don't know what that was about at all. You know, that had to be politics and not law.
Tim Dunn.
Well, I think one thing about the issue of eminent domain is it's one of the few issues that the left and the right absolutely agree on. None of us like the seizure of private property by the government. And one of the problems we've got, incidentally, in the state of Virginia, has been pointed out by Attorney General Cuccinelli, is that there are no specific protections for private property in the Virginia Constitution, and we need to put them in there. The U.S. Constitution guarantees the protection of life, liberty, property. Property is an important part of the protections that we need to experience as Americans and that increasingly are being infringed upon. When we reach the point where we're strictly looking at economic benefit in return for the seizure of private property, we have crossed way over the line, and we have really torn down the constitutional protections that are guaranteed for private property.
Do you support renewal of the Patriot Act? Why or why not? Beginning with David McCormick.
No, as it stands now, I do not believe it should be renewed in full. There are some very good points about it that can be divided out, litigated before the courts and the halls of Congress and the Senate. So there's some good merit individually for a few things, but overall the package, I believe, goes contrary to our constitutional rights. And if we compromise our liberties, if we compromise our security, then we've compromised our freedom and our nation. So though it was in reaction to a great tragedy from 9/11, it needs to be fully re-examined. And I believe the power of the individual trumps the security of the United States, except in extreme cases. But I'm not in favor of accessing the internet to check all our conversations. Are y'all?
Kevin Chisholm.
This Patriot Act, probably to come up with a really clear response on this, I'd want to talk with an attorney to have knowledge in the area. But given what I understand about it, there's certainly a balance between liberty and fear. And fear is often exaggerated and used politically. And not to a So I'm very much in favor of liberty weighing out heavily in this topic.
Tim Duncan. Well, I think we've always had a tension in this nation between liberty and security. And it's a sliding scale. The more liberty we give up, the more security we have, and vice versa. Historically, if you look at the record, when President Lincoln suspended habeas corpus during the Civil War, when we put Japanese Americans into prison camps during World War II, we were protecting security at the expense of liberty. And I think it's always a very, very delicate question. Section 215, particularly of the Patriot Act, is particularly troubling because it allows the FBI to seize documents and other items from individuals with a very low barrier for showing probable cause. And I think that the Patriot Act as a whole, I wouldn't throw it out. I wouldn't throw out the baby with the bathwater, but there is some bathwater that needs to be drained out of there. There's no question.
E.W. Jackson.
No, I would not support complete repeal of the Patriot Act. I think anytime we give the government authority to examine the records, the communications of Americans or anybody for that matter, we always need to be looking closely at that and making sure that our constitutional rights are protected. But we ought to be clear that we're not talking about protection of property. We're talking about protection of American life. We lost 3,000 people on 9/11. And we need to be aggressive about doing what we can to ferret out plans to kill us. And I think, therefore, that the Patriot Act in spirit is the right thing. And we just need to look at it closely to make sure that we're not being abused. And I'll tell you one thing that I would immediately do away with if I had the authority to settle that is these ridiculous searches that are taking place at airports. We need to start profiling for the kind of people we're looking for instead of searching little girls and grandmas.
Thank you, gentlemen.